Grit with Grace is brought to you by Zoetis. Your dedication runs deep, and it fuels everything Zoetis does. To protect and support cattle and those who care for them, we are Born of the Bond. Learn more at bornofthebond.com.
Driving back to rural Dewey County in western Oklahoma floods Terry Burleson with memories and images from 3.5 years ago.
How I escaped this wilderness here on fire was by the grace of God.
There, among the web of canyons and charred cedars, Terry survived, a miracle, left behind after nearly 300,000 acres burned in April of 2018.
Right back that away.
Okay.
Terry and two family members were in a side-by-side scouting places to turkey hunt the following morning when they saw the smoke.
It seemed to be a long ways, and we weren't taking on any smoke. So it just felt like it was 10, 15, 20 miles away.
A glance back a few minutes later, and the fire was on top of them. Pushed by 50 mile per hour winds, a wall of flames racing across the landscape. The road back was blocked, and so they ran, through two canyons at least.
From that point is where we, for whatever reason, we decided to split up. I don't know why, even to this day.
Somewhere, Terry lost his phone. The other two men, via fence lines and dirt roads, found a way out, while Terry ran for his life, up hillsides and down canyons, until he couldn't.
My mind was telling me that the fire was going to jump any moment, and I'm going to be sandwiched. So I kind of, in my mind, I kind of gave up. I mean, I laid down to die.
As he listened to the fire howling around him, he found peace.
Talked to my wife once. I talked to her and told her we were out on foot, we was in it, and it doesn't look good. I wasn't scared. I don't know, maybe that's a God thing too.
The heat rolled over him. The burning drove Terry to his feet. Gasping through smoke, he climbed out of the canyon, stumbling here onto flat ground. A change in the wind, a slow back burn, and using the road as a fire line.
The way that road angles and the way the wind was blowing the same direction, that's the only thing that allowed that fire to back burn past me.
Before roaring back to life.
Because that grass was about this high. So you can imagine the flames were probably 10 foot, just a big wall of flames.
Terry worked his way from one safe spot to another, laying as flat to the ground as he could beneath the smoke and eventually forced back into the ashes.
You know, from my vantage point, laying down on the ground, it looked like inferno. So I jumped up and run back over there and got on that burnt part.
As the fire raged past and the night began to settle, Terry got to his feet, disoriented, hurting, and lost. By chance or by providence, he turned left down that road.
Something told me to go left. And I think I was very fortunate because when I turned the corner, I saw the water trough and the windmill.
Water. He wet his face, but didn't drink, worried it might make him sick. Then he laid down out of the smoke on the cool concrete ring.
This was where you spent the night?
Yeah, right here.
Meanwhile, his family feared the worst, kept away by authorities and the raging fire.
Knowing what the wind was doing and seeing the fire and watching it on the news and seeing all those things, you're holding out for hope. You're begging God that he survives and you're praying all through the night. You can't sleep hardly. I mean, you know, everyone was worried and nervous and scared and frustrated and, you know, and just everyone woke up. I said, it's time to go. We got to go find him.
The next morning, a few hundred yards at a time, Terry followed the trail across the pasture to a dirt road and then started toward town.
And when I got across the cattle guard, about the cattle guard, that's when I saw a pickup coming.
He sank to the ground. The men offered him water. 5 minutes later, his family arrived.
When we pulled up to that cattle guard, I saw him sitting in the road, and I threw it in park, jumped out, jumped up in the air, screamed, he's alive, he's alive, thank God he's alive. I've got to call his wife. And so I grabbed the phone and I called her and I said, we found him, he's alive. And then I hung up on him. And then came back over here and said, you know, kept talking to him. And then, you know, I just put my phone down and that's all they knew is that he was alive. And then I got in trouble for that. And they said, you know, you didn't really give us a lot of information. I said, all you needed to know was he's alive. And so the ambulance is coming, the helicopter's coming. And
local ambulance driver Katrina Bryant was the first to arrive.
Truthfully, you were in good shape.
Just to where I'd been.
Yes. I mean, I was expecting to be doing a body recovery, truthfully. And the way that fire was burning, we probably wouldn't have found a body. We probably would have found ashes.
Seeing him alive lifted everyone's spirits.
When they found you, the talk on the radio chatter was just renewed life.
Terry spent 21 days in the hospital, suffering third-degree burns on his arms and parts of his torso. His head and his face had first-degree burns.
Your clothing wasn't actually burnt. You were burnt under your clothing.
Exactly how and why he survived is a question he's grown to live with.
The only way out was the way it happened, or I don't survive it. You'll hear God's in control. Either he is or he isn't. It's one of the two. It can't be both.
I know that if the same thing happened to me, he wouldn't stop until he found me. And you know, that's just a story of brotherhood, a story of friendship.
I try not to get emotional about it. To come back and see it is all still a little bit surreal in your mind that of what happened.
From the fire and ashes to walking among the living, a miracle. Thankful for every step along the way.